Call to the sixth session in the webinar series on the theme Rural Technology for the Socioeconomic Development of Grassroot Level Women, which is being organized by Vigyan Prasar. We are extremely privileged to have with us today renowned solar energy expert, Professor S.B. Gon Chaudhary, Mission Innovation Champion and Chairman NBIRT Kolkata. We extend a warm and heartfelt welcome to you, sir. We also have with us Dr. Kinti Dar Gupta Mishra, Scientist F at Vigyan Prasar. We also welcome the coordinators of Women Technology Park, NGOs working for grassroots women, DST Tara Core Group members, and all the scientists, researchers, and people who are attending this webinar through various other platforms where it is broadcasted live. Before I invite Dr. Mishra for the welcome address, I would like to remind the audience to mute their microphones and cameras for avoiding any disturbances during the session. Also, I would like to encourage the audience to avail the opportunity to interact directly with the speaker as well after the talk, or they can pose their questions and queries related to the talk and the women in the comment section on YouTube and this GoToMeeting session. Moving on, I would like to invite Dr. Mishra for the welcome address.
Thank you, Tusha. A very good morning to all. Welcome you to today's webinar. Increase in access to energy is crucial for development in rural parts of India. However, to have a holistic approach towards development of the community, it is essential that the energy access should not be limited to electrification and should be focused towards enabling the community through its use. In fact, in rural areas, even access to small amount of electricity could be a game changer and can provide the first step out of poverty by providing new skills, creating more entrepreneurs and source of income. This also leads to improvements in health, access to clean drinking water, education, communication and digitization. Women play a pivotal role in rural communities and have always emerged as the pillars of rural economy due to their total involvement with agriculture, healthcare, and other domestic activities. However, they lack powers of decision making, economy, and choice when it comes to selecting the means of lighting and cooking. So women and children are more susceptible to the harmful effects of unclean fuels used for lighting and cooking and for other domestic work. Solar energy interventions in rural areas help in bringing about gender parity by creating women entrepreneurs to lead a solar power revolution in rural India. The overall outcome of the distributed renewable energy like solar lighting, home solar systems or mini grids has a direct impact on women. In today's session of the webinar series is aimed at improving the public awareness of the importance of science and technology and how it is useful in rural areas. We also aim to identify and conclude on the areas which need more focus and attention of the change makers. And this series will subsequently help in reducing this gap of communication between the beneficiaries or the end users and make rural women believe that technology revolution is possible in rural areas as well. And we aim to promote positive change through adoption of innovations and make beneficiaries partners in the process. On a positive note, there are a group of private, public, and governmental S&T institutions and research groups working in the field of rural technology, targeted especially at the rural population, as the one we have with us today. So it is a great privilege to have with us Professor Shantipada Gon Chaudhary, an international expert in the field of renewable energy and electrical energy by profession from Jadavpur University. He served government of Tripura, government of West Bengal and Northeastern Council for promotion of renewable energy. He was director of West Renewable Energy Development Agency, Government of West Bengal, and also Special Secretary Energy to the Government of West Bengal. He did pioneering work in the field of solar photovoltaic. His work received worldwide recognition. He received National Science Academy Award, Ashlin Award from UK, and Euro Solar Award from Germany for his outstanding contribution in providing energy access to millions of people on this planet. He worked throughout the world different states of India to provide electricity in the unserved areas. The mini grid concept was introduced by him. India's first 2-megawatt grid connected to solar power plant in Asansol was introduced by him. He designed the first floating solar power plant of India. He's also visiting professor of IIEST Shibpur. He has invented microsolar dome, which has become the national program now and helping thousands of slum dwellers of India. Mission Innovation Champion. He's the first person who achieved this prestigious award from India. He's a fellow of Institution of Engineers. Dr. Gaurang Chowdhury traveled extensively throughout the world to realize his dream energy for all. He has contributed and he has written 4 books on renewable energy. He's the member in the Energy Expert Committee of Government of India. He's also the chairman, International Solar Innovation Council, Helsinki. Today, Professor Gaurang Chowdhury will enrich us with his contribution in transforming the lives of rural women using solar energy. The topic of the webinar is Reinventing Off-Grid Solar Revolution for Social Transformation. A warm welcome to you, sir, and we'd like to have your presentation and talk. And after the talk, as Susha has said, we'll have a discussion. And this program is also running live on YouTube and social media, Facebook Live. So those who will be attending this program, they can post their questions on the window on the panel, and those some of the questions will be taken after the sir's talk and presentation. Thank you, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good morning to everyone. At the outset, I must thank Vigyan Prashar and Dr. Pinkini Mishra for giving me opportunity to speak in this webinar. And this is a very important topic. And thank you very much for all other members who have joined in this webinar. The topic is very important. Topic is very important because we are now, accustomed with grid-connected solar. Everywhere we are talking about grid-connected solar, the megawatt-scale solar. But initially, when we started the solar energy activities, you know, at that time we were working for the rural people. But gradually, you know, in what happened, we shifted our concentration from the rural area to solar energy application from rural area to urban area. And that was a mistake, I think. I believe that was a mistake. Now, why I'm telling, because if you look at the scenario, you will see that for more than 850 million people residing in the rural parts of India, energy is an issue that significantly impacts their health, education, and income generating opportunities. You see, still, you know, if you look at the Indian context, and particularly Southeast Asia also, if you look at what you will find, the 1.6 billion people in the whole world, you know, they don't have access to electricity. And our contribution, Indian contribution, is quite significant in this picture. But though we mentioned that, we have electrified all the villages, all are having electricity, all are having energy. But really, if we look at the reality, then we'll find anywhere, it may be a village of Uttar Pradesh, it may be a village of West Bengal, or I often travel in Northeast, I'm basically from Northeast. If I go to Arunachal Pradesh, you have to walk for 2 kilometers, and then you find a village having only a population of about 20, 30 people. They will never get electricity. They burn kerosene oil. So those areas, you know, still in India, about 30 crore people in India, they don't have access to electricity. So whatever picture we are getting from the power ministry, that is good. We are also very proud of that we have electrified all the villages of India. But in real sense, electricity has gone to the villages, yes, physically, but practically, if you look at, I'm a practical man, and I'm talking about the practical reality. You know what is happening. If you look at the practical scenario, then you will find the electricity has gone to particular four or five houses of a village, those who are rich in the village, and the poor community still they are depending on kerosene oil or other type of lighting devices. So coming to the next slide, with 70% of India's population living in remote, low density rural areas where centralized electricity grid are unreliable. Just note down that word. I'm not denying that electricity has gone to the villages. Yes, as per Power Ministry's, you know, notification, all the villages of India are electrified now, except very few. But the electricity which has gone, you know, it is very, very unreliable. And it has reached the village, but not the all households. That point is very important. Whether we have been able to provide electricity to all the households? No. We have provided electricity in the villages. Yes, in the village we have drawn the electricity line. Distribution line is there in the village. But if you look at a village of 100 houses, 100 habitants, say 100 houses with say 500 people, you will find only connection level, electricity connection level is only 30%. And 70% people are not having electricity. So that is the reason the per capita energy consumption of rural India is also very low. The per capita energy consumption of rural India in some places it is only 300 to 400 units. So this indicates that though we are claiming that yes, we have electrified all the villages, but the electrification has not been done household wise. That is the problem, and that we have to solve. Now, can we solve with conventional electricity? That is the question. The conventional electricity, what are the problem? The problem of conventional electricity is that the energy security is very low, you know, in the villages. You see, if you give the electricity in the villages, what happens, I tell you, if there is any load shedding, if there is any power cut needs to be done by the central group from the urban area, the urban area, urban people of the distribution company, people who are sitting in the distribution company, they will first disconnect the rural feeders. That is the standard practice, that let us disconnect the rural feeder first. So because they don't want to disturb the urban areas, because urban areas, all the most of the activities are going on in urban areas. Though rural areas, a lot of activities are going on, but we don't give cognizance to that. We are more concerned because in urban areas, if there is no electricity, then there will be a lot of, you know, criticism. So we don't bother about, you know, rural areas, we disconnect. So that is one point, that in rural India, the electricity or the energy availability in rural India is very low. Though we have officially electrified the rural areas. That is one. Now, second point is the voltage level. If you look at the voltage profile of the rural areas, the lines are drawn, long lines are drawn, distribution lines, where voltage regulation is not there. And when the power reaches to the village, remotest corner of the village, I have seen some village in the Bihar, state of Bihar, where the distribution lines are drawn for about 35 to 40 kilometers, and the voltage level is only 140-130 volt at the tail end, where they can't run anything. Forget about the motive power. Forget about running of a motor of simple one, small device which can really increase their product income or something like that. So they can't do that. So this is another problem. The voltage problem, the unreliability problem, the reliable power they don't get, voltage problem. So what we can do? That is the main point now. So the point is, can we really make happy all the rural people with the distributor, that is with the conventional electricity, or could we concentrate on distributed energy source, where the reliability factor is very high and availability of electricity is assured electricity, and people, that is the most important point. People, they are the owner of their electricity. They don't depend on they don't depend on the distribution companies, the lineman of a distribution company who in one go just simply cut the line, disconnect the line of the rural areas. So in this context, the next slide. In this context, there are some good news that lot of activities, you know, the lot of activities are going on. A number of clean energy driven products have been developed in India to improve socioeconomic condition of rural areas. Particularly clean energy, you know, if you look at the clean energy in India, you'll find there are, we always speak about solar energy, wind energy, biomass, micro hydro, geothermal. So a lot of distributed energy sources are there. But out of many sources of distributed energy source, you know, you'll find the solar energy is the most attractive one for the rural people. If you look at India now, you'll find in rural India, solar pumps are operating, solar lights are operating, solar, all devices are operating. So solar energy, I'll be concentrating more on solar energy, though I'll also touch a little bit on cook stove and other things, but more on solar energy I will discuss. Solar energy is the real solution. The India has, since it is a tropical country, as you know, India has got a very high potential to tap solar energy. Anywhere, as I have mentioned, in Arunachal Pradesh or anywhere in Northeast, if you go, if you want to set up a solar power plant, you can set it up in 2 hours' time. If you want to give electricity to the rural areas, you can give electricity in rural areas in 2 hours' time. That is the uniqueness, that is the novelty of the solar energy system. So the solar energy is very popular and it is becoming very popular, but the devices, you know, the various devices which have been developed recently, I will try to show you, because I find women technology park people are there, various core groups are there. I know core groups are also working very hard on energy sector. So I'll give some idea where India is really lagging. India needs a renewable energy solution, in a renewable energy based solution for those areas. I'll be coming to those areas now. Next one. You can see the solar light. If we think about the rural areas, first of all, we find that light in rural areas is absolutely essential, and that is people are using still the candlelight or kerosene lamp. Many of the houses, I have seen thousands of houses who are still in India who are using really kerosene lamps, and still, and some people, they don't use any light, they just simply go to the bed at 6 p.m. So that is the condition of India. So solar energy is a solution. Solar lighting, you are all aware about solar lighting. The number of solar lighting systems are working, solar home lighting system and solar street lights and other things are working. But I'll be telling you about a very new product which has been developed by us, and now it is a very popular item throughout India. This product is being utilized. That is, you know, the micro solar dome. The micro solar dome is a very simple, innovative day and lighting solar device appropriate for rural, remote rural areas. So the micro solar dome, what is micro solar dome? You know, the normal solar lighting, the normal home lighting system, which you are aware of, that gives the light for say 4 to 5 hours in the evening time, 4 to 5 hours. But the micro solar dome, this is a unique system which you know, which has a two-way, you know, it's unique in the whole world. It is absorbing, in one sense, it is capturing the passive daylight. You know, why I'm calling daylight, why I'm talking about daylight, if you go to the remote areas, rural areas, forest villages, tribal villages, and if you enter their room, what you'll find? Even in the daytime, the forest villages, even in the daytime, you can find the homes are, rooms are very dark, because they do have windows, but they close the windows because of the wild animals. And during daytime also, their rooms are dark. So, and they are having a candle. I have seen a lot of houses where candles are being used during cooking time. So what I thought, let us capture the daylight and let us give it, which is we call passive solar light. And that passive solar light can be given to the people for the whole day. So this solar, you can see the micro solar dome, there is a dome on the top which captures the daylight. You will be, it is very interesting. It is capturing the daylight, and there is a, you know, next one. I'll explain. So you can see the bottom portion, there is a lower dome. What happens, through the upper dome, sunlight is captured during daytime, and there is a, you can see there is a tube. We call it a sun tube. Through that sun tube, in the sun tube, there is a reflector. Through that reflector, solar energy is captured and it is concentrated, and through the lower dome, it is given to the room. And during daytime, believe me, during daytime, they get light like anything in the homes. And what happens, interesting point we have seen, they are now using, the rural people, the forest villages, they are using this micro solar dome in their toilets. What happens in the rural toilets, when they go to the rural toilets, then they close the shutter, they close the door, inside the rural toilet become totally dark. And in Sundarbans area of West Bengal, I have seen in the toilet, poisonous insects or even the snakes, they take shelter. So even in the during daytime, that happens, and a lot of accidents occurs. So you see, they are putting the micro solar dome so that in the daytime itself, they are getting light like anything. It's a wonderful device. They are getting light with that during daytime. So this is one unique development, I should say, and we should all try to popularize. At the same time, if you look at the micro solar dome, you will see the micro solar dome has got two solar panels. The two solar panels, and in front of the micro solar dome, there is a, a junction box, one, the box type of thing, electronic circuits are there, which gives light during night time. So a micro solar dome is a, solar passive and active device, which works for the 24/7 basis. Anytime you can get light from that, it is not like a home lighting system. So what happens, with the panels, with the two panels, the solar energy is concentrated and it is charged in the battery. There is a lithium-ion battery inside, and that lithium-ion battery will give lighting source, lighting power during night time. And one more interesting part in the micro solar dome is that there is a mobile charging facility. In Rajasthan, we have given this micro solar dome in Rajasthan Palmer area. The tribal people, they are walking for about 5 kilometers. They are walking for 5 kilometers and just noted down 5 kilometers to charge their batteries of the mobile phone. Now they are charging their batteries in their home itself with the micro solar dome. So the micro solar dome is a unique device, which is now Government of India has also launched a major program to provide 50,000 micro solar dome to all the tribals and the SC families. Already 15,000 to 20,000 micro solar domes are working now, and MNRE, also Ministry of New and Renewable Energy Sources, they have introduced subsidy on the micro solar dome, and gradually it is becoming a national program. So I should, whoever attending this webinar, particularly the Women Technology Park group, you can also think about the micro solar dome application, and you can keep it in your, you can see how women are more interested. Next slide, please. You can see most of the, because energy is arranged by the women, and energy responsibility lies with the women. And they are all happy with the micro solar dome. You can see the micro solar dome. People are coming up. They are taking the micro solar dome, installing the micro solar dome. And that is a micro solar dome has upper dome, as I have mentioned. the description of the microsolar dome. It is improving the indoor environment. And if you go to the tribal families, tribal homes, you'll find the normal tribal homes are very, very damp in nature, you know, because they don't get any sunlight. Now, with the microsolar dome, the rooms are dried out and very hygienic. It has improved the indoor environment condition, reduced the indoor pollution, and in all respect, it is helping the poor people, particularly the poor people. It is not a very high-fi thing. It is not a very powerful light. It is only 6-watt LED lamp. So it is helping the poor people. DST, thanks to DST, they have taken up this program. Thanks to Minister, Honorable Minister DST, who has passion on this particular program. And due to him, only we could introduce the microsolar dome in Delhi, one of the slum areas in Delhi, where some people, some homes are also using microsolar dome, because in slum, one interesting point is there. In slum, if you look at the slum area rooms, if you look, they don't have any windows, and entire all the slum rooms are, dark. So with the microsolar dome, they are also getting daytime lighting, and nighttime lighting, of course, they are getting. So this is all about microsolar dome. It's a very new device. And as I have mentioned, the Women Technology Park can also think about this program. Next one, you can see some application. You can how people are, income generating activities. It is how people are using microsolar dome for different purposes, for education, for income generation, for many things. A recent study carried out by MBIP indicates it is not only economic activities, not only charging on mobile phone, but it is also helping the environment. The recent study carried out by NBAT indicates that 10,000 microsolar domes we have studied, it has reduced 270 tons of carbon dioxide, 4.8 lakh liter of kerosene oil on annual basis. Coming to now, lighting is in rural area. Lighting is very important. I have told you one solution for lighting. How with solar energy you can give a solution. Similarly, cooking is also a very important thing in urban area. We are all using LPG and we are all very comfortable with that. But still, in rural India, you see the cooking devices are still there dependent on firewood. So what we can do, a lot of development has been done and you are all aware about that, the improved cook stove program. I just mentioned because unless it is an integrated approach in rural area, for energy requirement is there in rural area for lighting, for cooking, for irrigation, for sanitation, for drinking water. So unless you handle the case in an integrated manner, impact will be not there. So I always try to solve in an integrated manner. In a village, the total energy solution, that means their energy requirement for cooking should come from renewable, for lighting should come from renewable, for their drinking water should come from renewable, irrigation should come from renewable, sanitation should come from renewable, and that is how a clean village, a smart village is formed. So cooking also, next one. Cooking also, you can say, status of access to clean cooking fuel. A recent survey carried out by WWF shows that bottle gas supply is almost negligible in most of the tribal and forest villages. I'm again and again touching the tribal and forest villages. They are mostly deprived. They are some people. So we must look at those villages where, really we can help those people with the new technology, with the renewable technology, with the solar energy technology. The cost of each LPG cylinder increases at least by 33% by the time it reaches the end user. That is the unfortunate part. Next one. Most of the BPL families cannot afford to make an upfront payment of rupees 800 to 900 for an LPG cylinder. So they're still, as such, they are still using the conventional chulas, conventional ovens, and with the firing. So next one. You can lot of there are different type of cooking fuel options in the remote villages. We have also given lot of improved cooking devices to tribal areas, and this is directly helping the women you can see various types of biomass based cooking devices have been developed. Many, there are many groups in the country, I know, and many groups are doing excellent work. So they have developed this type of cooking devices. So wherever my point will be, whichever village we adapt, in the village, we should solve all the energy problems so that there is an impact. So we should address the cooking energy need, lighting energy need, and all other energy needs. There, these are much more efficient than conventional foodstuff. Need of the hour is to scale up such use of such devices. Now, from foodstuff, we come to next one. Access to safe drinking water. This is one very important area. India has the maximum number of people, about 63 million, living in rural areas without access to clean drinking water, according to a new global report released to Mark World Water Day. So think about the Indian condition, the clean drinking water. We are walking in this area. We are seeing still the schools, the institution, the rural community, they are still dependent on either tube, Mark II tube, or ordinary tube, or even they are depending on, particularly in Northeast, they depend on the streams, the chodas, the hilly streams, and other things. Still, they are not getting proper drinking water, clean drinking water facilities. So the reason behind this, you see, why they are not getting? Water is available, source is available, but they are not getting clean drinking water. That again, the reason is shortage of energy. There is no energy. Electricity is not available in the villages in a proper manner, so that, you know, the cleaning process, that is the purification of water, the water purification, for water purification you need energy. You even think about your home where you are using a RO system. In the RO system, unless there is electricity, your RO system will not work. Though electricity requirement is very small, its requirement only is 30 watt or 35 watt or 40 watt, very small. But in a village, that 40 watt energy is not available. That is the main problem. In a remote village, from where you get 40 watt electricity? There is no electricity at all. If there is electricity, that electricity is not reliable. So if you want to give reliable drinking water supply, you need very small quantum of electricity in rural areas. And for two purposes. One is for pumping of water and also for purification of water. So we have developed, and many people are also working on, the solar water purification system. Next one. A solar water purifier. You can see the solar water purifier, thanks to DST for sponsoring this particular project. You can see the, as I mentioned, the RO system, reverse osmosis system, which are working in your home, that needs only 35 watt. But if you go for a community-based RO system, that needs only 60 watt of electricity. Only 60 watt of electricity. And for pumping, you need a micro pump. Only 100 watt pump is good enough, because our drinking water requirement is not very high. We need about 5 liters per capita drinking water. So it is not very, in a village, if there are 100 people, they need only 500 liters of water. And if you have storage system, you need 1000 liters. You need to purify only 1000 liters of water. You need to pump out only 1000 liters of water. So what we did, we have developed, and many people are also working in this. They have developed the alternative DC-DC system, which DC-DC converter, which really from solar energy, converting that power into regulated voltage, and that solar power is supplying the power requirement, energy requirement of the purification and pumping power. This is nothing, very simple device, very simple device. A total development of, say, costing maybe 10,000 rupee, 8 to 10,000 rupee, a system, which will drive the RO system. It's a UV system, which required electricity, and it's a water purification system, which requires electricity. So only with this small 30 watt DC-DC system, from the solar power, you need a solar power panel of say 40 watt capacity. We have developed the solar water purification system. You can see now at least 100 solar water purification systems have been installed, and there are already two entrepreneurs who are fabricating this type of, you know. As I forgot to tell you, the micro solar dome are manufactured by three entrepreneurs now, and they are startups. They are now manufacturing micro solar dome and they are supplying micro solar dome. Similarly, the solar water purifier also, we have transferred the technology to the some startups. They are now making this fabricating this solar water purifier, and these are being installed in various schools. Wayne TC, from their corporate social responsibility fund, they have taken up a major program in Northeast, to install this type of solar water purifier in various remote tribal schools where there is no clean water for drinking purpose, that is not available. So this is available in three categories. You can see solar water purifier 100 liters, 200 liters, 400 liters. 400 liters per day is for small community. 200 liters per day is for little bit in the larger institution, and 100 liters per day is for a small institution. So in different category, you will get the solar water purifier, and you can demonstrate the solar water purifier through the Women Technology Park or through anything. But these are now a very new technology, very recent technology. It has come up and it will be available in the market. Really, it is available in the market now, and hopefully by next year, a large number of solar water purifiers will be working. Now, solar water purifiers are working in Karnataka, in West Bengal, in Odisha, in Tripura, in Assam. In these states, solar water purifiers are working. Next one. The solar water bed removes, solar water bed removes iron and other sediments and kills all bacteria through ultrafiltration and UV system. The operational power of the system comes from sun, as I have mentioned. 2 days storage capacity is there. If sun is not there, solar energy storage is a problem. If sun is not there, so what is there? There is a storage tank. If sun is there, for 2 days, you can store the solar, pure water in a storage tank, and you can use this for next, that is we call 2 days autonomy. Next one. Advantage of solar water purifier, you can see solar energy stored as a clean water. No inverter is used, it is a direct DC-DC system. No pollution, no maintenance, no batteries are required. Next one. Solar-based sanitation. I want to give a maximum emphasis on this. Swachh Bharat Mission was launched on 2nd October 2014 with an aim to achieve universal sanitation coverage in India. It is an excellent program. The program mainly deals with construction of toilets, both individual and community level. A large number of toilets have been constructed in rural India under this program. Next one. Now, most important point. Probably you have noted CAG. CAG has indicated recently, it came in the newspaper, that whatever toilets we have constructed, out of that 40% toilets are non-functional. Why non-functional? Because there is no running water in the toilets. So why no running water? Because there is no water supply in the village, or there is no running water in the toilet. So, because there is no electricity. So how you can solve? Such a huge investment we have made, but our toilets are not non-functional. Our Swachh Bharat toilets, most of the toilets are non-functional. I should say, a toilet is only complete when the toilet has got 24/7 basis running water inside the toilet. Otherwise, the toilet is not complete. It is most unhygienic. It is a mess. So under such circumstances, significant number of toilets constructed under Swachh Bharat Mission remains non-functional or not under use. So what is next one? In this context, an integrated solar-based water purifier and running water system developed for rural washroom has made a significant impact in rural areas. IIST Shippur, they are also working on this. The system has a small solar power generating unit, which simultaneously done a solar water purifier comprising of our system and filtration system, and at the same time, a small micro solar pump is there, which is really, I'll show you the photo picture. Next one. You can see the micro solar pumps are this. These micro solar pumps, they are not doing anything. They are just simply from the water source, water body, the water lifted to the top of the toilet. This, look at this toilet. These toilets were non-functional, totally defunct before 1 year. Now the toilets are totally functional. Because what we have done, we have only added only three things, you see. Just a small overhead tank where these micro solar pumps, they are pumping water to the overhead tank, and you can see the solar panels, which is running the micro solar pump, and in the toilet, you are getting 24/7 running water. So, at the same time, from the overhead tank, you can take a pipeline to the solar water purifier also, if you wish. So, you can see in that school, particularly, they have taken a line to the solar water purifier, and the tribal boys and girls, you can see the poor tribal areas, you know, they were not having anything. Now they are using solar water purifier, as well as they have got 24/7 running water in the toilets. So I think this is one very important area where country needs your help. The total number of, you know, Swachh Bharat, number of toilets constructed under Swachh Bharat is huge. And the core support group or the Women Technology Park, they must take a, you know, note of that, and they must help how these toilets can be made functional. So that is one, and technology is available. Technology is available. Yeah. Already these technologies we have done. Many groups, they have used this technology, and in Madhya Pradesh, in Chhattisgarh, in again in West Bengal and Odisha, you know, this type of systems are working now. Next one. Solar energy is also important. I think I'll take another 5 to 10 minutes time. Solar dryers, you know, in rural tribal areas, rural forest villages, you know, they can't dry their crops, they can't dry anything, and due to that, they sell their product at very cheap cost, at a very low cost they have to sell. So solar dryer is a readily available system now available, which can be promoted by the Women Technology Park. And these solar dryers, I know many core groups are using solar dryers, they are working very fine. And this solar dryer can also be utilized, as I was mentioning, a complete solar village can we think of. Can we think of a complete solar village? Can we think of a complete clean energy village? Something integrated. We have done enough work as an isolated manner, as an isolated. One solar dryer we have given, one solar pump we have given, one solar light we have given. No, my point is, if you adapt a village, just find out the total requirement of the village, energy requirement of the village, and try to solve the total energy requirement of the village with solar energy or other renewable energy. You know, then it is a sustainable model. Then it will be a sustainable model. And at the village level itself, there will be some enterprise, you know, some small entrepreneur who will run the system, and we will really sell energy at a cost, and that is how this can be sustainable. In fact, I tell you about the rural water supply, you know, solar water supply. We have adopted a village in Tripura where rural water supply we have installed solar base, and the people, there is one entrepreneur in the village who is just saving the water of the water purifier in a bottle. And he's selling the bottle at 5 rupees per bottle, and he's earning a lot of money. So this is how, you know, you can really convert the development into a commercial entity. So this is how we can make a really solar energy based village, and in a sustainable manner. So solar dryer is one of the important component of that area. Next one. Now Now you can say another point. In the village also, the land for solar power plant, you need land. So in the village, most of the land are used for agriculture purpose, for other purpose. So where do you get the land? You need for solar power, you need some little bit more space, because solar power is not really concentrated energy source. It is diluted energy source. So you need some, say, 1,000 square feet or 2,000 square feet area. So now, but in the village, there are a lot of water bodies. So we thought, the country is also now thinking in that line, floating solar power plant can be set up in a village where a bamboo-based structure, where bamboo-based structure can be made. You know, in the village, a lot of bamboos are available, and bamboos, you know, it floats in the water. So can we put bamboo-based structure, and we can put a solar panel on that, and from there we can really supply the electricity to the solar pumps, to the drinking water system, to the sanitation system, everywhere. So this has been developed. This is in the country. The first solar floating solar power plant was installed in the year 2015. Now the program is matured. Now we are able to set up solar power, floating solar power plant in the villages to, as I mentioned, to solve the entire energy need of the village. So I will show you some picture of the floating solar power plant. You can see a floating solar power plant. It is a small, it's only 1,000 to 1,500 square feet area. You can generate 15 kilowatt power from 1,500 square feet area, and a small cable you have to bring from the water body, and you can just supply power to all the areas. So this is how, I think my slides are almost over. Now, India has achieved a lot in the sector of science and technology. This includes space science, biotechnology, nanotechnology. Everywhere we have done a lot. Once I took one of my friend, German friend, consulate from the German consulate of Kolkata to a village in Sundarban. And there, we have put up a solar water sanitation system. So there, some people were asking that we need a more solar water purification system and solar sanitation system. So the German, he told India is sending spacecraft and rocket technology. India is so advanced, and India cannot supply water in their rural toilets. It is not good, he mentioned in that, in his address. I didn't like that. So what should I tell you? All the groups, I know all the grassroots level workers are in this webinar, who are really working in the field. You are there. A country like India, where all the facilities are available in the urban areas, but most of the facilities are not available in the rural areas, only due to shortage of energy in the rural areas, shortage of reliable energy in the rural areas. Can we really think about that? And can we really make some solution in an integrated manner? That yes, this is a village, this is a forest village, this is a tribal village, this is a scheduled caste dominated village. In this village, we have solved the problem of the entire energy requirement by adapting solar energy and other renewable energy sources, and the systems are running in a sustainable manner. So this type of thing, that is my dream. I think in village, yes, solar energy. We are doing a lot of activities in urban areas, big power plants, megawatt scale power plants also. So we are setting up. That is one story of solar energy. But other story of solar energy should be, I believe, that we should take the solar energy in the villages, in the remote areas, where it makes sense. And all the problems of the solar, of the rural people, can be solved. All the problems, means I told you about where they need energy, they need electricity through solar energy. No problem. All the problems can be solved. Only thing, some R&D works maybe might be required. But I'm sure with your knowledge in this field, you can definitely make Indian villages also green and clean and sustainable in nature. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for patient hearing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for such an enlightening talk and very insightful talk. And indeed, we need to have a sustainable model, which for that we need to have a solar energy-based village to solve the entire energy need of a village. As you have rightly said, that access to clean energy, clean fuel, will help developing a smart village. So I think the need of the hour is to scale up such devices, like you have done a pioneering work in Microsoft Dome, which is an innovative device for lighting solar devices, and which is very appropriate for rural women and tribal women, for the women in the rural and the tribal areas, and which is benefit, which will provide not only in that economic activities, it is not only enhanced, but also make it very environment friendly. Thank you so much for your illustrious talk. Now we'll open the session for question answers, for interaction. So the participants who are online on this platform can directly ask a question, interact with Dr. Gaon Chaudhary. And we have received some questions, so which we will take them up after this, after the interaction on this platform gets over. Thank you.
We have a question from Vijay Tilak sir, and he's online also, so maybe he can interact with.
Vijay, good afternoon, everyone. This is Vijay Tilak from Vashi, IFSA. IFSA is an NGO, sir. We are having it for the last 47 years. We have many solar projects, solar hot water we have, solar PV, solar thermal, rainwater and all. But the solar cooker or cooking systems, they were very prevalent in rural India. How can we take it to a hostel of 150 girls? And where are they available? That's my question. Thank you. It was a very informative talk, sir.
Thank you. You see, solar cookers, there are number of manufacturers in the country. There are different type of solar cookers, you know, box type solar cooker, concentrated type solar cooker, different type of SK40, and different type of solar cookers are there. So the solar cookers, some solar cookers, you know, for community base, say for 100 people, 200 people, some solar cookers are there which have to be fabricated. And for home base, that is family based solar cooker, these are all available. There are many companies. If you can go to the internet, you'll find there are lot of companies who are making solar cookers. But Gujarat, many companies I know, and in Karnataka also, who are making solar cookers, you will find that. And that the problem with solar cooker is that, you know, in the eastern India, solar cookers are not the climatic condition. So the solar cookers are all popular in the western India or northern India. So the manufacturers are also located in northern India. So you can inquire in Gujarat, in Rajasthan, and also in Karnataka, also there are manufacturers of solar cookers.
Thank you, sir. I look for the Gujarat company to manufacture something for us. Thank you so much.
Okay.
So next question is from Mr. Prabhat Ranjan, and he's online. So maybe he'll ask directly.
Hello.
I think he's not audible, so I'll ask the question myself. His question is that compared with the energy for fossil fuel, solar energy systems are flexible and they provide a low maintenance, and environmentally they are very sustainable. But they have limitations, like mostly farmers which are low marginalized are not able to afford those solar systems. So what do you think, that will the renewable energy sources have the potential to overcome the power crisis in India, especially in the rural area? Sir, was I audible?
Tell me.
Prabhadranjan, can you ask a question directly to sir? That would be better. You can't hear. Tusha, you have to repeat the question again. You're not audible.
Yes. Ma'am, am I audible now?
Better.
The question is, compared with the energy from the fossil fuels and the solar energy systems are very flexible and they have a low maintenance cost.
It is not audible.
You raise the volume of your system.
Hello.
Carry.
किस तरह से इकोनॉमिक होगा ये सब चीजें, जैसे वाटर प्योरीफायर है और पंप्स है, तो ये क्या विलेजर्स के लिए मतलब इकोनॉमिक होंगे? वो क्या इसको अफोर्ड कर पाएंगे सोशल लेवल पे?
नो, सोलर एनर्जी यू नो कॉस्ट हैज कम डाउन लाइक एनीथिंग. सोलर एनर्जी सिस्टम्स आर नाउ टोटली इकोनॉमिक. Particularly the for villagers, pumps are very economic now, and even then Government of India is giving some subsidy, though subsidy amount is less now, but now solar energy price has come down like anything. I tell you one thing, the normal electricity cost is about 5 rupees now, whereas the solar electricity cost is about 3.50 rupees. So in fact the solar energy cost has come down, but you know, the initial capital cost is required for the system. Here, when you take a connection from the state distribution company, you need not to invest on the capital. But if you want to put up a pump in your field, agricultural field, then you have to install the pump from your own resources. But for that also, you will get a very soft loan from the bank. So the entire solar energy program is now commercially viable, and it is becoming very popular since it is now commercially viable.
Okay, thank you.
Next question is from Pooja, and she is online only, so she'll be asking directly.
Hello.
Yes, you're audible, Pooja.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Yes. Yeah, I can hear you.
Sir, I'm Pooja Ghosh, and I'm student. I'm studying from Amity University, and I'm pursuing my PhD from there. So, sir, I want to know one thing, that you have been one of the pioneers in India in the field of solar energy and designed with a rich experience of executing number of solar PV projects in India. So, sir, how do you see solar energy market evolving over the next decade? Hello?
Okay. No, good question. I tell you, solar energy market will be very big, because solar energy is gradually becoming a mass program. You know, particularly the solar rooftop program is becoming really popular. Everybody, they are going for solar rooftop system. And as I have mentioned, in villages, the people are now aware, that awareness has been generated. Earlier, there was no awareness. Awareness has been generated. So the market is linked with the awareness. People know, I can solve this problem with solar energy. So I believe in the next decade, solar energy market will be much more in India, and India will have the one of the very, very large market, you know, of solar energy products. And there are two types of market. You know, the one is generation of power from solar energy. That is, you put a rooftop system in your roof, and you use that power for your electricity consumption. That is one. And another is, fabricate some solar energy product and you sell it in the market. So there are two types of markets. So both the markets are going up, you know, the solar energy based systems are being installed. At the same time, solar energy based products are also being fabricated. So both the markets are very strong now, and I'm sure in the next decade it will be huge. The rural India is just coming up, so it will be a huge market in the next decade.
Thank you so much, sir.
Shall we have any more active questions from this platform, or shall I move to the YouTube questions, ma'am?
I have one question for Professor Ganchoudhury. I just want to know that what is the technology adoption at the community level of microsolar domes, sir? And another question is that what is the kind of production cost for microsolar dome? How are we? What is the production cost and a normal microsolar dome? And you said photovoltaic microsolar dome. So what is the production cost, sir? And does it require too much of maintenance, or is it a very low maintenance device?
So it's a good question. Microsolar dome is a low maintenance device. It's maintenance practically initial 3 years, there is no maintenance. That is a low maintenance device. And the cost price, there are two types of microsolar dome. One is daylight capturing microsolar dome, which costs only 400 rupees. And one is photovoltaic integrated microsolar dome. That cost is little bit more, 1600 rupees. We are trying to reduce the cost, but at present, with present volume, present demand, the cost is like that, 1600, 1700 rupees. Integrated, that is photovoltaic integrated, along with mobile phone charger. That cost is about 1600 to 1700 rupees, and only microsolar dome with daylight capture is about 400 to 500 rupees. And well, the people are accepting the technology. We have already trained about the country has trained about 500 solar technicians at the field level who are now really setting up microsolar dome. They are all from the villages. They know the technology, how to install the microsolar dome. They are also doing the marketing. They are maintaining the microsolar dome. So that is how microsolar dome is becoming very popular. And interestingly, the industries are also coming up to sell the microsolar dome. And another important area is microsolar dome. The CSR program, corporate social responsibility program, microsolar domes are distributed in many of the villages of India. So that is also one important area. So the villagers are now quite habituated with the operation and use of microsolar dome. And the installers are also available in the market. The cost is also not very high, but cost is coming down. As you have pointed out, the cost is not very high, but even then we want cost should go further down.
Okay. Can I intervene here, Kinkini?
Yes, sir.
No, actually the point you are raising, it is really valid question. We have done, you know, this 10,000 microsolar dome field testing in varied climatic regions. You know, this has to be put in the roof. So there is a problem when you are working in the mountain or you want to put there. So it is a problem how to fix that. That kind of R&D work has been done by NBIRT, and they have come out with a solution, because fixing of microsolar dome is also a problem. So that's why they have come out with a solution by doing the adaptive R&D work across the country, involving 26 core groups. So that's what they have done. And another thing is that DST has done, we have involved WWF India Network, because they have the small groups across the country around the protected areas, and that has helped us to connect with the forest department. So now in the non-grid forest areas where electricity or that grid is not allowed, these micro solar domes have been taken up by the forest department and being put in their protected area. So that is the link we are exploring, and that has been done through the WWF India network. So that is the adoption of the system.
Technology.
And of course, NBRT is working reducing the cost. That's what we are looking at.
Thank you so much, Dr. Agarwal. I have one added question to this. Like, sir, Dr. Gonchaudhary would like to ask you that we have these WTP parks, which you have already mentioned, and they have lots of beneficiaries who are self-help group women. So, sir, Dr. Agarwal mentioned about WWF India's network. So it is really possible to train these SAGs who have been formed under WTP network. So how can one get connect to this WWF India or NBIRT groups? So I just want to know so that we can also give this information to the WTPs and they can also get benefited. And these SAG women can get training and then can be involved in this entire technology program adoption at the community level.
Sure, we are always ready to train. You just ask these women technology power groups or self-help group to contact us, and definitely we'll be ready to train them. There'll be no problem.
Fine, thank you, sir. Okay, thank you. Tusha, any other questions that you have received? We can ask, sir, and we'll.
Yes, ma'am. There are some questions from the YouTube platform. Yeah.
Please.
There's a question from Dr. Nilima from Science City, Punjab. And her question is like, would they like to install a floating solar power plant for demo purposes? And they have a 1 kilometer long canal, which can be used for that purpose. What is the cost of that small demo plant, and which agency they can contact for a demo unit?
Floating solar power plant, its cost is little bit more than the normal power plant. It is about 40 to 45 thousand rupees per kilowatt. So in the canal, if you put up, it will cost around 45,000 rupees per kilowatt. Now, if you go for a 10 kilowatt system, it will be about 4.5 lakhs. And if you go for a larger system, the cost will come down a little bit. If it's a 100 kilowatt system, it may not be 45 lakhs, it may be 35 lakhs. So, thumb rule is like that. Per kilowatt, 40,000 rupees.
Okay, sir. There's one more question. There's some Tapan Malik. And he's interested in knowing any internship or hands-on program in and around Kolkata and for senior citizens like me. He's very much interested in and he wants to have some hands-on programs.
Yes, there are hands-on programs, but at this moment, unfortunately, due to this pandemic, we are not operating our training programs. But yes, regularly we get support also from DST for the training program. Regularly, we have a course support group. So they continuously organize training program, different type of training program for renewable energy systems. So they can easily join, but at least for a few days, we have stopped our program. But we are expecting to restart the program from the month of December.
I think this is the last question, sir. This is from Dr. S.G. Audaria. And he's asking, government institutions in rural areas need to be empowered with solar energy, which is to be free of cost by the government, as it can help the institutions to run at a lower cost. Are there any such schemes going on recently or in the past? Or they may be coming up? Was I audible, sir? Shall I repeat the question?
Please, you do.
Yes. Just repeat.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Sir, this is a question from Dr. S.G. Audaria. Government institutions in rural areas need to be empowered with solar energy, which should be available free of cost by the government, as it can help to run the institution at a lower cost. Are there any such schemes which exist?
Mostly, funded by the state government. State government, they do have funds. for funding, they do have fund for, you know, solar energy systems for the institution in the rural areas. I know many state government, they are funding such type of project so that the operational cost of the rural institutions come down because of this solar energy systems. So only thing they need to contact the state nodal agency in this respect so that they can get the fund for installation of the of such systems.
But sir, system can be designed as per the needs. That's what you have evolved a system that is integrated intelligent controller system using solar energy.
Yes.
For lighting, for flushing, for drinking water. Integrated solar system that is already there. Only we have to see at the location what kind of requirement is there. That based on that they can design. Of course, the state government has to come forward for that.
Yes. And that integration, I have mentioned, that integration should be there, system. That intelligent controller should be there.
Yeah, fine. I think as of now, we are done with the questions. There would be many, some more questions on the YouTube. So, sir, we would like to send these questions through email to you, sir. And whenever you have time, you kindly answer, respond to the questions. So we have come to the end of the session and we would like to thank Professor Gonchowdhury once again for such an informative talk, and it was illustrious. And it was, I mean, we really, the whole world of solar energy and how it can really transform the social, it can do the social transformation, it can really make changes in the lives of the rural people and especially women, because I think, as you mentioned, that energy responsibility lies with the women in the rural and tribal areas. It was such an honor and privilege to have you, sir, today with us in the session. And we look forward to many more meaningful engagement with you in future. And thank you, all the participants and the experts and all other people who have joined today, and we are thankful to you. And once again, Professor Gonchowdhury, we express our sincere gratitude and thanks to you for coming onto our session. Thank you so much, Ashkar.
Thank you so much. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sunil.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Agarwal.
Thank you very much, Sunil, for the comments.
Thank you.